it folly praise that fancy loves. I praise and love that child whose heart no thought, whose tongue no word, whose hand no deed defiled. I praise him most, I love him best. All praise and love is his, while him I love, in him I live, and cannot live amiss. Love's sweetest mark, land's highest theme, man's most desired light. To love him life, to leave him death, to live in him delight. He mine by gift, I his by debt, thus each to other due. First friend he was, best friend he is, all times will try him true. Though young yet wise, though small yet strong, though man yet God he is, as wise he knows, as strong he can, as God he loves to bless. His knowledge rules, his strength defends, his love doth cherish all, his birth for joy, his life for light, his death for end of thrall.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
By the Immaculate Conception, O Mary, make my body pure, my soul holy. My Mother, preserve me this night from mortal sin. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
By the Immaculate Conception, O Mary, make my body pure, my soul holy. My Mother, preserve me this night from mortal sin. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
By the Immaculate Conception, O Mary, make my body pure, my soul holy. My Mother, preserve me this night from mortal sin. Good afternoon. Today, Wednesday, the 17th of March, 2021. Today is Feria Day, the Wednesday after Sunday Letara, with a commemoration of the feast of Saint Patrick. From today's Roman Martyrology. At Downpatrick in Ireland, the birthday of Saint Patrick, bishop and confessor, who was the first to preach Christ in that country, and who became illustrious by great miracles and virtues. At Jerusalem, Saint Joseph of Arimathea, noble, senator, and disciple of our Lord, who took his body down from the cross and buried it in his own new sepulchre. And in other places, many other holy martyrs, confessors and virgins.
Deo gratias.
Today is Wednesday, and this day is kept in honor of Saint Joseph. And tomorrow is Thursday, and kept in honor of the Blessed Sacrament. Dear soul, a hearty welcome to the broadcasting of the Transalpine Redemptorist, the Sons of the Most Holy Redeemer, from the Holy Island, Papa Strondsay, in the Diocese of Aberdeen in Scotland. May God bless you abundantly with his blessing of divine and holy love. Thank you for staying with us, despite of the bad internet connection at times. To ensure a fast enough internet connection on our isolated island, we use an internet connection over satellite. There are problems with the satellite service, which causes that the live stream broadcast is cut short sometimes. We do what we can to solve this technical issue, but we cannot avoid getting cut short. If the broadcast should be cut short today, please do come back tomorrow and we'll try again. From the glories of Mary by our Holy Father, Saint Alphonsus. Chapter 3, Our Hope. Section 1, Mary is the hope of all. Oh, how many who were once proud have become humble by devotion to Mary. How many who were passionate having become meek. How many in the midst of darkness have found light. How many who were in despair have found confidence. How many who were lost have found salvation by the same powerful means. And this she clearly foretold in the house of Elizabeth, in her own sublime canticle. Behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. And Saint Bernard, interpreting her words, says, all generations call thee blessed, because thou hast given life and glory to all nations. For in thee sinners find pardon, and just perseverance in the grace of God. Hence the devout Lanspergius makes our Lord thus address the world. Men, poor children of Adam, who live surrounded by so many enemies and in the midst of so many trials, endeavor to honor my mother and yours in a special manner. For I have given Mary to the world, that she may be your mother, and that from her you may learn to lead good lives. and also that she may be a refuge to which you can fly in all your afflictions and trials. I have rendered this my daughter, such that no one need fear or have the least repugnance to have recourse to her. And for this purpose, I have created her of so benign and compassionate a disposition, that she knows not how to despise anyone who takes refuge with her, nor can she deny her favor to anyone who seeks it. The mantle of her mercy is open to all, and she allows no one to leave her feet without consoling him. May the immense goodness of our God be ever praised and blessed for having given us this so great, so tender, so loving a mother and advocate. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Today is Wednesday, and on this day the reading is taken from prayer, from the great means of perfection and salvation, by our Holy Father, Saint Alphonsus. Chapter 1, The Necessity of Prayer. Is it good and useful to have recourse to the intercession of the saints? That it is lawful and useful thing to invoke the saints as intercessors, to obtain for us by the merits of Jesus Christ that which we, by our demerits, are not worthy to receive, is a doctrine of the Church declared by the Council of Trent. It is good and useful to invoke them by supplication, and to fly to their aid and assistance, to obtain benefits from God through His Son, Jesus Christ. Is it good to invoke also the souls in purgatory? We may piously believe that God makes our prayers known to them, and then they, full of charity as they are, most assuredly do not omit to pray for us. Saint Catherine of Bologna, whenever she desires any favor, had recourse to the souls in purgatory, and was immediately heard. She even testified that by the intercession of the souls in purgatory, she had obtained many graces which she had not been able to obtain by the intercession of the saints. It is our duty to pray for the souls in purgatory. But here, let me make a digression in favor of those holy souls. If we desire the aid of their prayers, it is but fair that we should aid them with our prayers and good works. I said it is fair, but I should have said it is a Christian duty, for charity obliges us to succor our neighbor when he requires our aid, and we can help him without grievous inconvenience. Now it is certain that amongst our neighbors are to be reckoned the souls in purgatory, who, although no longer living in this world, yet have not left the communion of saints. The souls of the pious dead, says Saint Augustine, are not separated from the Church. And Saint Thomas says more to our purpose that the charity which is due to the dead who died in the grace of God is only an extension of the same charity which we owe to our neighbors while living. Charity, which is the bond which unites the members of the church, extends not only to the living, but also to the dead who die in charity. Therefore, we ought to succor, according to our ability, those holy souls as our neighbors, and as their necessities are greater than those of our other neighbors, for this reason our duty to succor them seems also to be greater. Fidelity, that is not only advantage for us to pray to the souls in purgatory, because they are very good intercessors when we pray for them, but also is a duty out of charity that we pray for our neighbors, for the souls in purgatory who suffer so much, which is far beyond our imagination. Dear soul, you are cordially invited to unite yourself with us to pray in the here and now. The goal of the live streaming is further to communicate the teachings of the Catholic Church, including those of our Holy Father, Saint Alphonsus. The form of today, first hour, notices and Holy Rosary, and in the half hour after that, Saint Patrick's Breastplate and the Exorcism Against Satan and the Apostate Spirits. And after that, devotions, the Novena Prayer of 30 days to the Blessed Virgin Mary, and after that, the meditation taken from the mystical City of God by Venerable Mary of Aquila about the Passion of our Lord. Dear soul, my superior asked me to relate about Saint Margaret of Cortona, who was a penitent of the Third Order of Saint Francis, and she lived in the Middle Ages. She was born in 1247 and died in 1297. Her feast day is the 22nd of February. Saint Margaret is a great saint, but in the beginning that was not so. Talking about sinners, our Lord said once to her, quote, "I've made thee the mirror of sinners. The most obstinate shall learn by thy example how willingly I exert my mercy to save them. Thou shalt be the ladder of sinners, that they may be brought to me by the example of thy life. My child, I have set thee as a light in the midst of darkness. Thou art a new star which I have given to the world, to enlighten the blind, to bring back into the right path those who have gone astray, and to raise up those who are sinking beneath the burden of their sins. Thou art a new standard under which sinners will return to me and walk in the way of penance, offering me their sighs and tears. Thou art a path to the hopeless, a voice of mercy." End quote. We know that however we have sinned, if we turn to our Lord and we ask for mercy with a heart full of contrition and with a sincere will to amend ourselves, He will forgive us. And Our Lord said to her, quote, O my child, be thou white by my innocence, and red by my love. Thou art the third light granted to the order of my beloved Francis. He was the first among the friars minor. Claire was the second among the nuns. Thou shalt be the third in the order of penance. Unquote. Margaret was born in 1247 in the town of Laviano in Tuscany. Her parents were respectable farmers. They gave her a baptism, the name of Margaret, which means peril. Later, our Lord said to her, O my child Margaret, thou art indeed become a peril in my eyes. Thou art my chosen one, my bride. Thou art a peril before God, lovely and resplendent for thy whiteness, holy and great by the power of my love. Unquote. Margaret's mother was very pious, and she tried to instill into her heart the fear of God and a love of virtue. But unfortunately, she died when Margaret was only 7 years old, and Margaret gave up her heart to vanity and cared only for pleasures, with the great danger to go to perdition. Her father neglected her because he was too engrossed by his agriculture pursuits, as the story tells. He had married a second time, and Margaret had much to suffer from the hard, violent, and passionate character of her stepmother. This was a great trial for Margaret, and this dragged her deeper and deeper in the abyss of sin. At 18, she was seduced by a gentleman of Montepulciano and fled the house of her father. For 9 years, she led so criminal a life that she was the scandal of the country. But people were apparently praying for her, because at times it happened that a ray of heavenly grace would penetrate the darkness of her soul and caused her to weep over her disorders. Stung with remorse, she would then seek out some solitary spot, saying, Oh, how delightful it would be to pray here. What a peaceful place for doing penance. During the 9 years in sinful pleasures, she was continually solicited interiorly by the mercy of God. The terrible struggle between her sinfulness and her desire of conversion came to an end by the following event, of course, orchestrated by divine providence. This is what the story relates. One day, the young lord of Montepulciano, her accomplice, went into the country to visit one of his estates. Margaret awaited his return the whole evening, the night, and the following day, but he never came back, sad at heart and filled with gloomy forebodings. Margaret sent a servant in search of him, whilst she anxiously watched every turn of the road till she saw the dog who had accompanied him running towards her. The dog was alone. He threw himself at the feet of his mistress, moaned piteously, and took hold of her dress together to follow him. Margaret, hesitating between fear and hope, followed the dog, which led her into a side path, through hedges and bushes, till they reached an oak tree, at the foot of which was a heap of leaves. Here the dog stopped short, scratched away the leaves, and brought to light the bleeding head of a corpse. Margaret uttered a cry of despair and fell down fainting. She recognized the livid features of a murdered lover. It was here that divine mercy awaited this great sinner to change her into a heroine of penance. Margaret immediately thought in her anguish of the terrible judgment of God, because she remembered her guilty life. She beheld with horror the sins that defiled her soul, and bitterly felt the shame of her past disorders. But soon her pious mother came before her mind, tenderly smiling at her and reminding her of the sweet joy and heavenly peace that filled her heart in the days of her childhood. These memories, together with a strong impulse of grace, took possession of her soul. Her tears now flowed copiously, tears of deep but calm sorrow. Grace had won the victory. Margaret returned to Montepulciano, and she put on a penitential garb, set the affairs in order, gave up to the family of the deceased all the property that was at her disposal, and prepared to leave the city. She went to Laviano. She threw herself at her father's feet. She wept and entreated him to admit her into his house. Touched with compassion, her father embraced her and consented to receive her. But her stepmother did not agree. She blamed her father for his indulgence and indicated the extreme bad reputation of Margaret, and so she was driven from her father's house. Where could she go? So she went into the garden to sit under a fig tree and wept there for a long time. Do you saw this kind of situations in life can be very dangerous, because if one is in big misery and has nowhere to go, how easily is one not persuaded by the devil to pick up the old life of sin again? And that was what happened to Margaret. The devil whispered to her that, rejected as he was, it was quite excusable to abandon herself once more to a life of sin. Luckily, our Lord gave her his light and inspiration. He touched her conscience and enabled her to make a resolution to go at once to Cortona and to take there the habit of the third order, and do penance under the direction of the Friars Minor. Margaret's soul was then fortified, and she did set out on her way. Next time we will continue. Rosie will be in a few minutes.
folly praise, that fancy loves, I praise and love that child, whose heart no thought, whose tongue no word, whose hand no deed defiled. I praise him most, I love him best, all praise and love is his. While him I love, in him I live, and cannot live amiss. Love's sweetest mark, man's highest theme, man's most desired light, to love him life, to leave him death, to live in him delight. He mine by gift, I his by debt, thus each to other due. First friend he was, best friend he is, all times will try him true. Though young yet wise, though small yet strong, though man yet God he is, as wise he knows, as strong he can, as God he loves to bless. His knowledge rules, his strength defends, his love doth cherish all. His birth our joy, his life our light, his death our end of
a joyful spirit.